Καλημέρα σας, dear colleagues. I'm very honored and very pleased to be here. And I would like to thank the Association of Librarians and Information Scientists, and especially Jorge Glosiotas, to invite me here to speak to you today. I always take a lot of new ideas back when I'm going to another country and to speak to colleagues. And I heard this morning about this wonderful radio show you're doing every Sunday, and I think it's a brilliant idea, and I will take this back home, and maybe we can do something for libraries as well in this way. So it's just great. I hope actually that you also get maybe some ideas out of my presentation. I choose as the title of my presentation a quote by the genius Albert Einstein, because if not a genius, who else knows? And he says, in the middle of difficulty lies opportunity. So what I'm going to do is I would like to give you first a little bit of background so that you know which context I'm talking about. I will give you a little bit of idea of the financial situation of German public libraries. And then I will go into various ways of what libraries in Germany are actually doing now to tackle this situation, how they deal with it. And the first is they try to get alternative funding, they try to improve the services to their customers, cooperation is very important, and then of course also to join forces in an association. So here are just some figures for you to place the whole thing into perspective. We have 82 million inhabitants in Germany, and we have about 8,500 public libraries, of which only, and this is important to know, something like 2,200 are run by professional full-time staff. And the vast majority, you can see here a figure well above 6,000, is run by part-time staff or volunteers, and a large majority, again, of these smaller libraries is run by the church. So we have really two kind of different systems, a professional-led system and a voluntary system, which is especially important in the rural area and in small villages. Then here you'll get some more figures about how many medias we have. About 8 million people are just registered users, but we have many, many more visits to our libraries. You can see these figures here. In Germany, public libraries are also regarded as public services, and they are mainly funded, at least those, and those are now the ones I'm talking about, those which are run by professional staff. They are mainly funded by the municipalities. And these municipal governments have various sources of income. The first is a share of the general taxes we have in Germany. And the other most important part is a business tax they are charging, and also property tax. So these are the major sources of income. And already in the 1980s, we had great problems with the finances on the level of the municipalities. Then again, after German unification, after 89, a lot of costs actually were involved in that. So again, we had big problems. And now again, in the economic crisis. So all this meant that we have very high pressure on the budgets, because our municipalities lost their main source of income, the business taxes. And on the other hand, they had to pay much more, of course, for those people who were unemployed. They had to pay welfare payments. So we asked last year our libraries for the first time in a survey, a very easy, very quick survey, whether they have been affected by cuts. And we found that half of them either have been already affected or will be affected. And we asked this year, let me just first maybe explain a little bit more about that one. When we found these figures last year, we went to the press and we used the picture of an iceberg, where we say, well, unfortunately, about 20 libraries are either closed or they have to reduce dramatically, maybe by closing a department. But this is only the top of the iceberg that is visible to the public. what is beneath the water surface, so to speak, and what is not immediately visible to the public are all the cuts in opening hours, for example, the reduced number of professional staff, for example, the cuts in media budgets are not visible, the cuts in reading events which are in the library, and of course also the request for the library to increase their income. So this year we ask again whether libraries are somehow affected by the measures that has to be taken to save money, by the fiscal consolidation measures, as they're officially called, and we asked not only our public libraries but also academic libraries, and we came that one third of them actually have to report that there were measures realized that had cuts in one way or the other, and 12% of public libraries actually said they had permanent cuts in staffing, 13% of the academic libraries, and reduced media budgets, almost 25% in public libraries and almost 30% in the academic libraries. At the same time, if you look at the last 10 years, we found that the loans have gone up in public libraries by 22%, so the demand in services is rather high. And at the same time, we have only in the same amount of time an increase of 3% of the media expenditure. So we have to do more with less. And these are the challenges for our public libraries as well. They are decreasing resources from the municipalities, and an increased use of public libraries, increased demand for their services. And at the same time, we all have to reposition our libraries and to adjust to the digital age. And we have to disseminate the knowledge on the value of the public library. Now, I guess that you will also hear from time to time, why do we need libraries at all? We have the internet. Well, this is something we are confronted with all the time. So how can we improve the situation? Many libraries suffer from cuts, and we find actually that every library can do something to improve the situation. If you use your creativity, if you use your own initiative, if you are solidary with your colleagues, and if you cooperate with other libraries or other local institutions, if you have good public relations, and maybe also some knowledge of alternative funding resources, then this should be possible. I'm going to give you now a few examples of how libraries in Germany actually try to find alternative funding. And you have to know, when I'm giving you these examples, that we have an ongoing discussion in Germany of whether a library should charge fees or not. The official position of the German Library Association goes back to the 80s, and we said, no, it should not be necessary, it should not be made, actually, to charge a fee to use the public library. But if the municipality is very poor, and if the municipality has to decide to somehow get some more money and has to charge, then at least the usage should be free for children, for young people, and for those people who do not have much money. So in fact, we find in Germany, I would think about half of the libraries, they have now a charge, and they have to ask for money. So what I'm going to present to you is really kind of what we call probably the necessity is the mother of invention, which is ascribed to the ancient Greek philosopher Plato. So we just try to do the best out of the situation and be creative. Maybe another background information which would help you now is that in the 80s, many municipalities tried to run their municipality a little bit more like a commercial company, to give their institutions a little bit more freedom. So we have some libraries in Germany who are really run like a kind of a municipality undertaking, and they are much more flexible regarding their income because they can keep it and they can use it for their own purposes. They just negotiate once in the year the whole budget they're having, and they can say themselves how much they spend on staffing, how much they spend on media, how much they spend on events. It's a greater flexibility. And what they do is actually they define some core services which have to be free for all, like entering in a library, using a library while you're there. This must be free for everybody. And they identified alternative funding sources for maybe additional services. Just to give you some concrete figures, we have an annual fee for library users which has to be paid once. As I said, in about half our libraries in Berlin, it's 10 euro. In other cities, it's 25 euros. And exempted from that are children or elder people or welfare participants. If you do not return your books on time, you are charged again as well. I just give you here an example of 25 cents per item per day, which adds up pretty quick. Internet usage. Many libraries are not offering free internet services, so you are charged 50 cents, 1 euro for the hour. And we have something where our community is really divided. The one half says this is a wonderful service and the other really doesn't want to have it, which is what we call the bestseller service, where we buy immediately as soon as books are on the best-selling list, piles of books, but if you would like to take these out, you are charged for that and you're only allowed to take it for 2 weeks. Then, of course, another fee, rental fee for the rooms, if somebody else from outside would like to use it, or you have events and you take an entrance fee. Then we have also libraries who are offering services which are offered also by other people on the market, like, for example, internet courses. And we find in Cologne in the public library that they even charge 20 euro if they have a course there for about 5 to 8 people. Würzburg is charging 4 euro for that. And we have also libraries who are offering their services to companies. They're doing research for them and they charge for company profile, for example, 5 euro. Or in Cologne, you can go there and say, well, I would like to apply for a job and I would need information on this company. And then you get a package for 7.50 euro. I get the company profile and you get a handbook how to do the job application. And if a company is coming there to the public library and say, well, we need to really have first-hand research, they are charged as well. Then we have the huge area of fundraising and sponsoring. Sponsoring really is more that you have to give something in return. Either you take the logo on your leaflets or some other negotiations you're doing. And fundraising really can be, I mean, contributing can really be everybody, the general public. You can ask foundations or you can ask your private companies. Very often it's a local bookshop or it's a local bank who is helping the local library. And you can really ask for everything, for either material, for projects or for events. You can run special campaigns. We had one for the setup of children's libraries, or you can give a gift voucher for the annual fee. I just mentioned, or maybe the mayor would like to give a dinner invitation with a famous author and people are asked to contribute then towards the cost and this money is given to the library. Or you even have a gala dinner and you ask before at local companies to donate products and they are then auctioned and the money again is given to the library. Just to give you another example, we have in Mülheim, in a public library, we have friends of the library group, and they have rented a shop, and they collect used books, second-hand books donated. They are donated to them, and they sell them there for 50 cents or 1 euro, and all the money which is taken in this way is given to the library. In Düren, which is a small library as well, they have created a whole concept, which they call the concept of small steps. And they have looked at various areas where they could actually read for sponsorship. And one I like a lot is the sponsoring by local crafts industry that supports reading, because our local crafts industry is confronted very often with young people who cannot really probably read or write. And so they are asked now to contribute so that a reading card can be given to every school bag. Another one I like a lot is Your Birthday for the Library. So instead of really asking for presents or getting presents from the people you invite to your birthday party, you just ask them for a little bit of money and you donate this then later on to your local library. We also have sponsoring examples for media. For example, in Würzburg, the public library asked the local travel agent whether they could sponsor the travel journals in the library. Or you even have a combination of a local car dealer who has paid, instead of a fee to the author, to give them a free annual car inspection. So in this way, the author was for free to the library charged a little bit of an entrance fee, and then they had a little bit of money out of this event. And in the Berlin Public Library, we found that a local retailer donated the furniture for the children's libraries. In Duisburg, this public library has at the moment no media budget whatsoever, so they have just zero, nothing. But of course, a library is only as interesting as its media, and so they came up with a book patron project. They cooperate with the local bookshops. They put on tables there many of the books they choose for the library, so they did really the selection. They said, these are the books we want. And book buyers can go there, they can buy a book and donate this then to the library, and their name is written in the book. And the same was done also by the City Library of Mainz. They have a lot of historic books, and it costs a lot of money, of course, to restore them. And they we're looking for sponsors for that. Again, the name of the sponsors written then in the book. We even find libraries who are working with online donation system, like the University Library in Konstanz. They have installed the PayPal system by which really everybody can just donate some money to the library. And I came across a very interesting example in Essen, where there is a website which is called billiger.de, which means cheaper.de. It's a website where you can find all kinds of products, and you can compare prices, and you can then choose the cheapest one. And they have a campaign for 6 weeks that if you buy certain books on their websites via their partner, their books.de, then this billiger.de will donate the same amount of money to the public library in Essen, so they can buy new media as well. And then I came across a new way of funding media or projects in libraries. I'm not aware of any library at the moment who's tried this in Germany, but I'm sure in America they've done it, and there are at least courses in Germany offered on that. And therefore, I would like to mention that here as well, which is the crowdfunding, which is an online platform with various offers. And you can collect their donations. You present your project there, and the money is kept until a certain amount of money is really there, and until the kind of time limit has been spent. And if you have been successful and all the money is there you need, then this money is released and you can use that. So in this way you can really get a lot of funding from a whole lot of group of people. Very important in German public libraries since the 1990s are becoming the friends of the library. They are extremely helpful. We had, of course, some friends of the libraries, but we see since the 90s really many, many, many more. And I would think at least in every fourth library there is now a Friends of the Library groups. They really improve the position of the library, and they help secure the future of the library because they speak up for the library. They are independent from the library, and this makes them so much more powerful. They really lobby for the library. Their membership fee that they pay, of course, an additional income source, but they are also able to go around the community and to raise some extra money. And they make presentations to the press, and they really work a lot and are very, very helpful for the library. And just to give you two examples, in Hamm, in the public library, we found that they even raised so much money that they can pay workers who are working there on in a minor employment for just 400 euro a month for helping out in the library, and this is paid by the Friends of the Library groups. Then of course they have literary groups that they run. Or in Heilbronn we have a project which is called Story to Give Away, where the library is placing volunteers, reading aloud volunteers, in local schools and in the kindergarten. And then, of course, the vast group of volunteers, which are becoming more and more important in our libraries. And they support mainly those library services that would otherwise not be possible at all. We have in Germany in the last, I would think, 20 years, always debates about volunteers, because many people feared that their jobs would be taken over by volunteers. But this is not the case. We actually can see now professionals are the ones who have to organize and coordinate the volunteers. You cannot run a library just by volunteers once it has reached a certain size. I said earlier on, we have many small libraries which are run by volunteers, but there's a real limit to what you can do regarding media size and opening hours. So we are talking here about volunteers in libraries with professional staff, and they offer additional services which professional staff, for example, cannot offer. We have, as an example, the Wismo Public Library, where they have a kind of internet advisor. This is really a one-to-one model. Elderly people who do not know really and are very unsure about the internet, they can go to the public library, there will be one person there, and there will be a one-to-one teaching of how to use the internet, how to use the email, how to use Skype, how to stay in touch with people, our relatives, which might not be in the same city. Or we have another project which is called the Book Dwarfs, where volunteers encourage young children which are living in residential homes, either refugees or immigrants, to learn the language of the country. Again, this is a one-to-one project. Or the Media Messenger, where volunteers are bringing books home to people which are not able to visit the local library. So this is really all done by volunteers. And then we have, since 3 years now, a new program, and it might be something which is of interest to you as well. There's something I think that needs to be some research being done in here. It's an American company, the TechSoup Global. This is a non-profit organization, and they are active now in more than 30 countries. They donate IT programs, hardware and software, and they have in about 30 countries partners which are running this with them, and they cooperate with us, with the German Library Association, and libraries are now able to buy all hardware and all software for their libraries, for all those computers which are in public use, for an administration fee of 4% only, meaning there's a saving of 96%. I put the website here in as well. I saw that they're active in more than 30 countries, and this might be something you would like to follow up as well. Apart from looking for alternative funding possibilities, there are libraries in Germany who felt that if they have less money, then they have to use this money better. They have to use it more effectively. They have to use their resources more effectively. And we have now, since more than 10 years, a project which is called the Strategic Library Planning, by which library directors develop their own individual strategic plan. Within 18 months, they are actually having workshops first for the first input, and then they exchange their experience in the middle of the project, and in the end, also they discuss the results. This is really the idea behind it, is that many libraries can no longer be library for all. They have to look for who are actually my customers, who are there, and then to ensure that they are best served. And the idea is also that it's much more convincing if you have a well-developed long-term plan than just going from one day to the other. And the whole thing will really improve the profiling of the library. So you look around your community, you have to identify who's there, what are the problems, have you more immigrants, have you more elderly people, have you a lot of unemployed people, and then you will really see what are the effects of the library. You research the hard facts and figures first to really determine which are your customers, and then you identify the problems of your region, of your municipality, and you position the library as the problem solver. I'm not going now through the various steps. If you're interested, you can just read this later on. But the whole idea is that you look first, who are my customers, and that all the services you are offering, all the money you're asking for, all the cooperation you are doing, all the measures you're taking, and also the way you communicate is all developed from this material. What are my customers? What do they need? And with whom do I cooperate to serve them best? I would like to go into another area which is also becoming more and more important, which is the cooperation. You can have, of course, cooperation with various partners. The first obvious one is the cooperation with libraries. And we have projects in Germany by which libraries actually exchange their media in certain rhythms. They increase in this way the offer they can give to their customers by just changing this. So we have, as an example, in an area in Rhein-Hessen, we have 30 libraries who bought altogether almost 5,000 DVDs. And every 4 months they will exchange what the individual library has to another library so they have new stocks to their customer. Or they even agree on common stock building in their area. We have built up a couple of years ago an internet library where we have a shared compilation of about 7,000 links in about 20 fields of knowledge, which is regularly updated. And very important, of course, here is this question service, which is run by the librarians. This is done automatically. You can type in by email your question, and within 2 days, or possibly even within 24 hours, you receive your answers by a professional librarian. Then, of course, very important also for us is the cooperation with schools. And here it is important to know that, due to various reasons, we do not have a tradition of very strong school libraries. Our guess is, we do not know exactly, but our guess is that only about 15% of our schools have professionally run school libraries. So in the last 10 years, we've done a lot to sign cooperation treaties. Our association branches in each of the federal states with the ministries which are responsible for the education. And we formed cooperation between public libraries and schools. And we have now a regular reading promotion services and class visits, and we have even school lessons in the libraries. And this is all done regularly as a part of the curriculum. So to ensure that each child is really coming to the library very, very regularly. And we also build up very strong links between the professional libraries in the public services, in the public libraries, and those school libraries which are mainly run by volunteers, either by teachers or by parents. And we, of course, also have now a growing cooperation with kindergarten, and I brought you one example from Kreuzgarten where first the children actually visited the library and they got story reading, of course. Then the parents were presented books in the kindergarten, those books which are very good for reading aloud to the children. And then in the end, these children actually produced the book themselves, a little of painting, a little of writing. And then now you can see that maybe very proud because their own book is now in the library and can be borrowed. Regarding new services, e-lending, we choose a different way than other European libraries. We went via one commercial supplier. There's a similar model also in the United States. It makes life easier for us because we have one supplier that is doing all the negotiations with the publishers, which is of course very, very time consuming and very hard. And we can use then these offers. There's one technical platform they are looking for, and this is an internet-based service, so there's no installation necessary in the library itself, and the technical support is also run by this company. Which means that in your library, the library user just goes to your homepage, they use the digital content, they just browse through that, and they put the material they would like to have in a kind of a library basket, log in with their personal data because this service is only available for registered library users, and they then just take out the material, they download it to their PC or to their e-book reader. This of course means that we can now also offer a 24/7 hours service, and we reach new user groups who very often do not use the library very often because they say, well, they don't find the time to come to the library. Now they can use the library coming from home. This also helps a lot in rural areas where people find it hard to find the next library. This is this kind of service is offered by about 300 public libraries at the moment. There are 50,000 media negotiated. About 70,000 are at the moment on offer. Some libraries form consortia, local consortia, to get this offer, and the bigger libraries are just having their own negotiations. Just to give you the example of the Berlin Public Library, at the moment about 5% of the registered library users in Berlin are using this. They have access to about 10,000 titles, and in very high demand we find this always our advice books on law and economies. I would like to give you also a little bit of information on what we are doing in the Library Association to support libraries, because our Library Association is only as good as the members it has. So we really try to do give a lot of support to our members by creating nationwide events. And we have now in the second year, and I brought a couple of copies. I left them outside, which is our report. You see, it's very, very thin. It's our report on the state of libraries. We started this last year. In the beginning, we always give the figures, that the ones that I presented to you as well. But then, of course, we also give page by page those areas where libraries really contribute to the community, what services they give to help young people to really enjoy reading, what services they give to elderly people, what services they can give to immigrant people, and so on. So this is really kind of in two parts. The one part really say, well, this is the state of the finances, and the second part says, well, this is actually what we could do. If we only had a little bit more money, we could do even better. I think this is a very important report, and we will continue to do that. We send this to about 1,000 politicians in Germany, and I just now receive a lot of letters back saying, well, this is very important. And this report is actually presented on the 24th of October, which is the Library Day in Germany. And this marks also the beginning of our image campaign, which we are running now in the fourth year, which is the Meeting Point Library. The basic idea is that during 1 week, all the events which are happening anyway in public libraries, which are not visible to the outside world, are made visible. We have created a common website, and on this website every library is including the events they are doing in this week. So in this year we had 5,000 events in about 2,000 libraries all over Germany, and this is of course something which is of interest to the media. All of a sudden they see, oh, there's something happening. So apart from this website, we also produce common material with a logo, so this is all visible, and we have famous people who are supporting the library as well. We are at the moment working on a position paper on the funding needs of public libraries, which of course then has also been distributed to our members, and they can use it as well when they talk to politicians. And we're expecting now in the next weeks the results of a study we have commissioned on the non-usage of libraries, because we feel that we need to know more about the reasons why people are not coming to the library, to be able to set up suitable measures to attract these people as well. And we produce a common PR material. Again, I brought this postcard. There are more outside. You can take these if you wish. These postcards were made for children libraries. We asked the illustrator to produce this once. We paid this once, and we made this available for free to all our members, so they can all use it if they wish. And the same with photographs. We commissioned all these photographs of people who are using the library. They're using different kind of materials. We have this on our website for our members, and everybody can just use it in their material, in their posters, in their leaflets, in which way, however they like, because this, of course, is the cost reducing is enormous in that. And this year, we have produced for the first time a small web clip. It's just 1.5 minutes. I'm not daring now to show this, but if you're interested, I think you've got a printout, so you can have a look yourself. We asked students of the Film Academy to do this little web clip, and they actually produced, I like it a lot, a very funny web clip by which they interview letters in the books, and the letters are actually explaining why they're so happy to be in the library. So if you wish, just test it yourself. So to sum up, I think the way ahead to improve our situation is, well, first of all, of course, we need to have more funding, yes. But I think we can do a lot ourselves as well. We have to look at our tasks. Are we really doing the right things? We have to review that. Are we really offering what our customers need? Do we have to offer new services? Maybe we have to skip services that nobody's really asking any longer. We have to build a very distinct library profile. We have to explain to people what libraries can do and what only libraries can do. There is no other place that offers quality information, quality books for free for people. And with professional staff, of course, to help you whenever you need help. We have, and I think this is an area we have to improve a lot, we have to cooperate even across municipalities to share resources. And we have to mobilize much, much more all those people who are voluntarily helping the library, who are voluntarily working for the library because they really like the library and they would like to support the library. And I think we have to continue to run a lot of unconventional image campaigns. And this is something we can all do by ourselves. So thank you very much.